Let's start. And firstly, let me say good evening to friends and colleagues of the Conservative European Forum. And it's a pleasure to welcome you all and to welcome our guest, Anita Hübner, from Poland and the European Parliament. I should first of all apologize for David Lidington, Stephen Hammond, and Vicky Ford, who've not been able to join us this evening, which is why I am hosting the occasion. And perhaps I could also just say at this moment a bit of sad news we have in conservative European circles was the death of Philip Bushell Matthews, who was a colleague of mine in the European Parliament, and he was also a chairman of the committee as I was in those days. But sad news and quite sudden. But from that, let me move on and come to our topic tonight, which is the situation of Poland. Poland, I think, has had a long history of friendship with the United Kingdom, and it's something we've always valued. In my own Parliament, Westminster constituency of Battersea, we had the headquarters of Solidarity with Solidarity and the White Eagle Club, and so there were lots of Polish activities in those days. And then when I moved across to the European Parliament, of course, I was we had the arrival of Poland as in membership, and I remember being rapporteur on the environmental impact of that move, and looking at Katowice and the water quality and the asbestos factory and other things. And then, of course, we remember the day when Lech Walesa came with all these speakers of the new member state parliaments to raise the flags outside the parliament in Strasbourg. And that was a great day. And then later we, as a group in the EPP, went to Gdansk to help celebrate the anniversary of the shipyard declarations. And Lech Walesa took us around, and we also had there Donald Tusk, who reminded us that that was his hometown, and so he was able to give us a bit of a history of that as well. But tonight we will be using the usual meeting format, which means please have your sound on mute unless you're speaking, please, if you want to ask a question, signal to us that through the by the raising the virtual hand or using the chat function, and then we can switch you on or silently switch you on when we come to the question. Well, Danuta, you are very welcome. Danuta was goes back some years in our joint history of Europe and. When I was looking at the arrival of Poland in the Parliament, I think in the community, Danuta was the minister in Poland responsible for that European affairs and the negotiations, and very successful they were. And then she arrived with us as a commissioner on two areas, I think, which she took on in those early years. And then in 2009, just as I was leaving the Parliament, she arrived in the Parliament as an elected MEP, and she's currently chair of the European Parliament's Committee on Constitutional Affairs. So she has many other aspects to her history and curriculum, which I won't go into in detail, but we look forward, Danuta, very much to hearing what you have to say to us about not least the Polish election and Poland in the European Union, and how you, as a Polish member of the community, see the future.
Thank you. Thank you. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, we can.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Well, first of all, thank you very much. Thank you, John, for the nice words. And Thank you, Simon, also for coping with all those things, which was not probably easy because it's very difficult to find time. And I'm very grateful that for you for the invitation, and also that you have such an idea to talk about my beautiful home country. I would like just to start by maybe saying that back in 1989, Poles believed that democracy starts with free and fair elections. And then we got a very tough lesson that elections are neither a guarantee nor the sole determinant of democracy. And we also learned that populism tends to be extremely effective in making voters look from time to time for authoritarian leaders. One would probably assume that such voters, I would say, you can find maybe or such voting priorities or preferences you could find in Russia. But then we also discovered that we can find them also in the US. And today we also see this type of voters with such preferences also in a number of European countries. So this shift toward a non-meritocratic populism, I would call it like this, happened in Poland back in 2015. So after 10 years after we joined the European Union, but much more in terms of after our shift towards democracy, towards market economy. And in 2015, we Poles, people, were offered a world where freedom of media does not matter, where rule of law or independence of judges and also international law, international legal norms do not matter. And between 2015 and 2023 in Poland, only more or less half of the population was recognized politically. Half of the society that voted for the opposition was actually excluded from political consideration by a political party who claimed to be the only one knowing how to, claiming that they were the only one knowing how to listen to the people, how to identify also their needs and also how to satisfy those needs. And the opposition, those who thought differently and for whom half of the population voted, did not matter. And the contempt for the opposition was the contempt for those who voted for them. And that was actually the contempt for democracy and for rule of law. And political gatekeepers, those who won the elections, opened fully the doors to all sorts of political figures with very low moral ambitions, which exacerbated kleptocratic risks and corruption. And only now we can see the size of abuse regarding public funding and regarding also other country resources. So we had 8 years, and during those 8 years, a formally democratic parliament existed, but not a single amendment was taken from the opposition for all the major legal acts. Budget was adopted without letting the opposition enter the room where the voting took place. People were, of course, not imprisoned en masse, but illegally spied with Pegasus. Now we have a special investigative commission working on this. People were also detained for many months without formalization of court procedures. There were also illegal methods of provocation used with dramatic consequences for the life of people. Very often, pregnant women, we had many cases of pregnant women dying because doctors were afraid of helping them. So we very quickly discovered this new situation after the elections of 2015. And gradually the situation was getting actually more spectacularly also extreme. And the ruling party moved quickly from populism toward clientelism. and public media were cemented as one-party media, and then citizens, especially women, began to be brutally harassed for participating in demonstrations, and the fear of the omnipotence of power was growing. And the constitution of Poland was actually captured by an illegal tribunal, which consisted of judges which were illegally appointed for the tribunal on the place of the judges which already were there. So for 8 years, we were deprived as citizens of an independent judiciary and also instances of control over the actions of state power. It disappeared. And political reality in Poland was gradually abandoning also the European values, which I think majority of Poles would appreciate very much as values, and also the rule of law. But the real damage to democracy was not coming with this gradual disappearance, weakening of the values, but from deliberate attack on democratic institutions. So we have, of course, at that time also in Poland, citizens' movements fighting for human rights, including the issue of abortion, but also the issue of minority rights, like LGBT, the independence of courts and judges. We also saw several times big actions by the parents of people with disabilities who were claiming also their rights. And we discovered very quickly, I would say, that democracy will not make it without the involvement of citizens. So the democracy needed citizens to defend it. And when democratic procedures were actually thrown out of the window, then people invented a lot of very innovative formulas to practice democracy. So we had all those street walkers singing the Polish and European anthems, reading every Sunday for 2 years, every Sunday, a preamble to the Constitution of Poland in front of the presidential palace, with thousands of citizens listening to it. There were also teams of judges that for years traveled through Poland explaining the constitution to the public at large. And the situation also of non-governmental organizations was dire. And those that were not at the service of ruling autocrats were actually deprived of any financial support. So we also, I would say that in a way, democracy was realized every day as a kind of moral commitment of citizens. And that was really emotionally extremely important for us. And the history of solidarity with a small s between people was practically written every day. We could see the heroic judges defending rule of law and also and European values. That were losing their jobs and their positions. We had teachers on strike. We had also many schools, I must admit, probably mostly in big cities, that were celebrating the Rainbow Fridays, which was then the authorities of the schools were penalized by the authorities of the educational system. And then we had also local governments. You know, Poland is strongly decentralized, and we have the local level and regional level is very important. So there were actions of independent local governments, and there were local leaders engaged for democracy. And you might maybe have heard a couple of years ago, actually probably already 4 years ago, one of those local leaders, who was the mayor of Gdańsk, he was murdered during the public charity event. He was on the stage and he was murdered by a man who was inspired by the language of hate against this mayor on a public television under the control of the ruling party. So new style of legislating also was kind of consolidated and became a rule. It implied bringing the laws to the parliament for the procedure and for the adoption, but not as government proposal, which is the rule in Poland, which requires always public consultation procedure, but they presented the laws as parliamentarian proposals and consultation then was not required. So we also got rid of having the Polish law being consulted through the normal constitutional procedures. So we had cases of the most important laws which were adopted during the night and then early morning, they were just taken to the president who was just signing them into law. And that has become actually a rule. But of course, we were not alone because we were part of the European Union and we chose actually to join the Union back in 2004, as you might remember, because why we did it? Because the history had never been good to a lonely Poland. So we knew we should not be alone. And we wanted to be a part of Europe. And then, of course, we fell as citizens with democracy. We fell in love with democracy. And there was this transition to market economy at that time and to the democracy. And the accession, which was in parallel, a parallel process, was for us also the light in the tunnel, the direction to follow, and also the guarantee, as we believed at that time, that the past would not return, but it sort of did return in 2015, and actually started when also kind of, as we were saying at that time, kind of gradual or crawling polexit also started at that time. We had, normally we have two levels of institutions that are protecting citizens, so the national level and then European level. But national institutions, they disappeared. They were at the service of the ruling majority, except for the ombudsman and except for something we call Supreme Control Office, which just happened that its lifetime, or because it's also elected, it just lasted throughout this whole period, so it could work. But those two institutions were completely ignored by the ruling majority, so it didn't matter what they were just saying or doing. At the European level, opinions and rulings of the European institutions, starting with the Commission, but also European Court of Justice, and also the Council of Europe, European Court of Human Rights, anything they did in terms of rulings or opinions, it was rejected by the government as not respecting the Polish constitution. So this so-called constitutional tribunal, which was rejecting anything that was not in line with government expectations, this tribunal also rejected in one of its ruling the you might remember still the supremacy of the European law, which is part of the beauty of the European Union. So the Union actually was, as you also probably know, was not equipped in instruments to cope with situations where member states response to the ECJ ruling by saying, so what? We think differently and you have no right to tell us what we should think. But the European institutions, they continue to react to each breach of the European law. There were also substantial penalties imposed on Poland, which was of course paid from our budget, from our taxes. Then also the independent judges who didn't give up. They were also asking all the prejudicial questions to the ECJ, and many of them demonstrated also the fact of independence from autocratic authorities.
Yeah.
But also Poland did not benefit from the funding from European Union because we didn't meet the conditions that were the rule of law. So we didn't give up on this, so we didn't get the funding. Only now we are trying to recuperate this right to get the funding. So it
okay.
was...
Danuta, thank you very much for that introduction. And I'd like, if I may, to come to some questions from our colleagues who are
sure.
around the country now. And you've given us a shocking story, of course, in
Yes.
terms of what can happen to democracy if it's taken over by people who are not benevolently attached to it. And we see that not only the downside, but you've also portrayed the upside of the resilience and the people out in the streets and eventually, of course, winning the election. But the election was a close run thing, I think. And I just, if I could ask you to look ahead to the European elections, you've just got away from one, and you're now coming towards the European elections. And I would like to know what you think will be the key issues in Poland during the election, EP election campaign,
Yeah,
and what
but
the winners and losers are likely to be.
Well, you have to also maybe be aware of the fact that during all those years, even if the support for the ruling party during those years was sort of maintained among the voters, their own voters, who are also different categories of people, but at the same time, the support for the European Union was very high in Poland. We have continuously practiced since the moment we have joined the European Union. We have above 80%, sometimes even close to 90% support for the membership in the European Union. So we have also citizens, confused citizens, who on the one hand were supporting the party, the politicians. That were openly and definitely moving against the European Union and towards Polexit, crawling gradual, but moving at that time. At the same time, these people were also supporting the membership in the European Union. That made it also very difficult for the party to be openly, I think, to openly terminate the membership in the European Union. And now we are approaching, of course, the European elections. But I can tell you that we, when we won the on the 15th of October the general election, now we are awaiting the local elections in April. So we will have two rounds of next elections, which will confirm, hopefully, the victory of October. And only then there will be the European elections. So we are not yet, I think, at the moment where the public opinion would be just sort of shaping around the European issues. In 2019, during the last elections, there were two topics: rule of law in Poland and climate. And I think that climate probably will continue to be an extremely important topic. I think we will be talking about Ukraine because that's a big issue. And as you can imagine, for Poland, it's a fundamental issues. And let me use this opportunity to say how grateful we also are to UK that you have been one of the first to come to be there. And also now David Cameron was, I think, last week also in Poland. And one of the big issues was also cooperation on security and on the war in Ukraine, and jointly asking the Congress to do their job.
Good.
But I think Ukraine will be a big issue.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I then bring in some of my colleagues and members here? And I'll call first on Liz Spencer, and after her, I'll call Michael Clough. I'm looking at the hands going up, so we have a number of questions to come. But Liz.
Thank you, John, and thank you very much, Danuta. Building on what you've been saying to us, how much do you feel Prime Minister Tusk can achieve while President Duba is still president in seeking to implement the reforms that he's aiming at, and how stable is the coalition?
Yeah. You know, the situation is, of course, extremely difficult because we were not allowed to form the government as soon as possible after the elections, but we basically had to wait 2 months till all the tricks available by law were used by the president of Poland and the previous government. So finally, we started right before Christmas, also the new period in Poland, the new era in Poland. And as you can imagine, the challenges are enormous because we basically have to do a lot of things at the same time. It's just building, rebuilding from scratch all the democratic institutions, the running also the current policy. Even the budget was blocked, still actually blocked, but not in a way that would not make it possible to go on normally. But the important thing is that we have this coalition, which has a very safe majority in the parliament. We, of course, there are differences. It's, you know, it's a coalition where you have people who are against the abortion and you have people who are in favor of abortion. You have people who have very different attitudes also to the role of church in our life. You have people, also you have political parties that are extremely, extremely tough on also looking into all the atrocities, all the irregularities, all the criminal actions that took place in the past. We have all the special committees also on Pegasus, on spying, and this is just incredible what we are discovering. Tons of corruption, kleptocracy, a lot of things. And but we are still united. I think there is a strong commitment that even if we have different candidates during the local elections, for example, in Warsaw, we have also different candidates for the position of the president, of the mayor of Warsaw from different parties of the ruling coalition. But my understanding is that there's no way that it will just divide the coalition, because the coalition is fully aware what we promise to the people, what people expect from us. They also know that only if we are united, then we have the sufficient majority in the parliament, and that's why I think it's a commitment which Tusk probably would just not allow anybody to destroy. And I think we owe him a lot, because he spent 2 years just traveling through Poland, talking to people in open meetings where anybody could enter the room, not like in the current opposition, when the meetings are only by invitation, the entry into the room to meet with the leaders. So I think we know what we owe to the people. We know that we cannot afford that there is a comeback to the past. That's absolutely clear that we have to do all those things. And also people are expecting from us that we also will show all the bad things that happened, all the evil that took place. And that's why I think we know that we have to stick together.
Thank you, Danuta. Can I come to Michael Plus then? And after him, I'll come to Philip Fairweather. Michael. You're on, need to demute. That's it.
Obviously, Ukraine is very, very close geographically to Poland. And you have all of the challenges which go with that. I was wondering whether we've read here of issues between Polish farmers and Ukrainian grain imports. And I was wondering whether there are ways of resolving some of those tensions.
Country with extreme potential when it comes to agriculture. I was told that some private farms in Ukraine are bigger than some of the member states in the European Union, probably Luxembourg or maybe Malta or Cyprus, I don't know. But so the challenge is enormous for us. And at the current, in the current moment, also Ukraine needs a lot of funding, which we are delivering as much as we can, but also they could sell their products at good prices globally. And that was the beginning of the whole issue, that Poland was supposed to be a transit territory. Like it was also true, I think, for Bulgaria or Slovakia or Romania. But unfortunately, there were also people or companies in Poland that wanted to make money on this. So instead of organizing the transfers through Polish territory, actually a lot of those products, raw materials actually were found the market in Poland, putting the Polish farmers at a very disadvantageous position. And that's how the whole thing started, still in the, I think, mid second half of last year. And that's very difficult now to get out of it, because we made a commitment as the European Union, institutional commitment to Ukrainians, that we will support also facilitate their trade with European Union, and there is a special rule for this. Now we are reforming this this rule to allow also member states to have some safeguards in case the situation on the market changes and works against the member state citizens and their job and their businesses. And we are voting next week. I think there are deadlines for amendments is for tomorrow. We will have those new regulation. We will see how it will work. So the only solution is through to ensure that what is transfer is transfer, and what is allowed to the markets of the European Union member states, that it meets all the safeguards, all the criteria, and that it is organized in such a way that we can that it can be seen as a normal situation, which is not disadvantageous towards Polish among other Polish farmers. But now it's going to be difficult, because those guys who are blocking the streets, who are having the problems with their product, they lost the trust. And now now it's this typical situation, to defensive situation, that we have to say that we have to change, that it will be changed, that it will be different. But the Commission made mistakes, I think, and national authorities made a lot of mistakes. And we are now trying to get out of this mess. And let's hope that we will find the solution for those countries that suffered most, like Poland. But that's only one issue, because another issue is that we are also, as you know, on the mission towards the green reality in Europe, and that also farming, agricultural sector has, I think, has not been sufficiently consulted by the European Commission, by the Polish Commissioner for Agriculture, and many farmers are not prepared to meet all the criteria which come with this proposed contribution of the farming sector to the reduction of emission and to greening the European economy. So then there is another sector which means cost and less benefits in the short term. Another issue is, of course, the energy and the increase of prices, which so the cost of farmers grew in the last years, and it was in France, I think, mostly, probably also in Germany, this factor, the cost of credit and a lot of things. So I think we failed as the European Union in coping adequately, properly with the challenge that our policies have brought to the farming sector, and that's why we just have to find a way out of it. But this is a combination of many factors, and we have to find the solution. And Ukraine, I think there's no other option. Ukraine is on its way to European Union. It's geostrategically important. We have to show Mr. Putin what is our favorite, I think, international order in Europe. Where is Ukraine? Where is Moldova? Where is the Western Balkans? And where is Moscow? So we have to do it. So it's difficult, but we have to be optimistic that we will find the way out of it. But also there is a lesson learned.
Thank you, Danutis. Very honest answers to some very difficult questions there. Let me then move on to Philip Fairweather. After him, I'll come to, actually, it's a name that comes up as iPhone, but I think I see the smiling face of Robert Morland behind it. So Philip and then Robert.
Hello. Forgive me. I'm a bit dyspraxic, so I'll try to get to the point as quickly as I can.
But you have this beautiful backdrop behind you.
Yes, I actually live in Poland, and I have done for about 20 years. And you can see behind me the beautiful City Hall of Wrocław. Yeah. Now, I've been here for about 20 years, and I'm actually a Polish voter. So for a long time, of course, Donald Tusk and Platforma Obywatelska, I supported very heavily because I saw them as the equivalent of the Conservative Party I know and love from Britain. And so in this current, in this current situation now, I've seen it rather, it's rather disturbed me that a lot of Conservative influencers, and particularly amongst the Brexiteers and people like that, threw their weight around behind PIS as if they were the true equivalent. And of course, this to me was really upsetting, having to try and set the record straight. And of course, I'm really pleased that now Donald Tusk is back in power, and I hope the coalition holds. And I think another thing that he ended up being vilified amongst a certain portion of people because of his because he suddenly, of course, became president of the European Council, and to them this made him, to Brexiteers at least, some sort of arch villain. Where of course it was really. To our advantage to have somebody like that in that position, who's basically on our side. And I think things would have gone a lot worse had it not been to us. But the what I'm wondering is, when Tusk having been out of the when Tusk took on that position, do you think it actually set the situation in Poland back and allowed the way in for PIS in a way that it wouldn't have done had Tusk remained in Polish domestic politics?
Oh, you know, it's a very difficult question, because I thought I would never forgive Tusk that he left, but but I had to, because there was no other probably option at that time, and it was important also to for Poland. I think it was important to we entered European Union as a big country with the good history of solidarity, with also, I think, a lot of potential and capacity to strengthen the European Union, and to have the president of the European Council was something that probably that was good to see, but of course the I don't know, maybe I what I think is this: what if think of this type doesn't make much sense. The good thing is actually that he got back, because actually if he didn't get back, if he didn't start in 21 when the 23 election was as far looming on the horizon but far away, and if he didn't spend those 2 years, as you know, just traveling through small and not so small cities, villages, and if he didn't talk to people in such a way as he did, we wouldn't have the elections, because the elections were decided, the outcome was decided by the mobilization of people, of young people, which we never had really participating so strongly in the elections. Women, with 74% of women, the turnout among those who were eligible, so that we never had such mobilization of generally 74% with young people and women so strongly represented. And I think that was, to a large extent, that happened because of Tusk. If not for him, I think there are not everybody just sees Tusk as his sort of political preference, but what he did for Poland is just, for all of us, I mean, for democracy, for having Poland back, for having Europe back in Poland, for the fact to have normal relations with Germany, France, UK, it just it's like a dream is just occurring now, coming. So I wouldn't let you say anything bad about Donald Tusk. I think we owe him now.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, well, I think we would also say nice things about Donald Tusk and the role he took during the problems of Brexit, and he did his best to help us to get through that, and we are grateful to him. And so pleased to see him back where he is now. Let me move on to Mr. iPhone, Robert Bourne.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and apologies for my new name. Can I ask, Dinuba, and to be frank, was it going back to her initial remarks, was it actually extremely unhelpful that my party, the Conservative Party, joined an association with the Truth and Justice Party by leaving the Christian Democrats and joining the group that they were in? But also to add to that, can I ask in relation to your agricultural answer, or partly in relation to your agricultural answer, is there a feeling of entire enthusiasm, which I do have superficially, for the idea that we should speed up Ukraine's entry into the EU after we've achieved the peace? Are we not being do they not feel it would be over-optimistic, for example, their terms on single market agriculture and other reasons? It would take a lot more people would probably think if we do it properly.
Yeah, well, you know, I also regret that, well, you are gone. So I regret that you are gone, and we miss you. But of course, I was not in the parliament when you moved to ECR. That was exactly when I was coming, I think, where you were leaving the EPP and going to ECR. But I knew a lot of you there, and I could never understand how this group can also, I think, stick together, because they were very different people, parties. But that's also an EPP. If you look at some parties, you can't understand also why they are an EPP. Or now we are also opening to more radical parties also, because before the elections there are those fears that we can lose our sort of position of the biggest political group. So there is a lot of danger. So I'm very, very strongly against just for the mainstream parties to reach out to far right or far left or radical parties, because I think there is a big risk that they will dominate sooner or later the mainstream party. And that we also made the decision on starting the negotiations. Sometimes we forget that Ukraine is not starting from scratch now. Ukraine, we had the first partnership agreement with Ukraine in 1994. Then in 2014, the association agreement, which entered into effect, I think, 3 years later. And there is this huge, hugely open already trade, comprehensive or enhanced, I think, trade agreement. So there is already a lot happening. And also Ukraine on many issues has also with the Commission kind of smaller agreements where I'm just opening certain aspects also of single market. So they are well advanced. The issue, of course, is the war. And the important thing is also now the Commission, but nobody talks about that, but the Commission is going through a major review of all the European policies to see where and why there is a need of changes to European policies, also in the context of the enlargement. And that's why we are, I think we are doing a lot to prepare also the policies, the single market, that's absolutely clear. Plus, we have to remember that, and I was myself negotiating for Poland those things, that in the negotiations, we also have this so-called transition periods where we, up to now, we are 20 years after accession, we don't have full direct payments in the agriculture. They are close to half of the direct payments. We didn't get a lot of, in terms of the quota in agricultural negotiations on agriculture, the quota, the prices, the access to milk quota, for example, which was the end of the world. So a lot of things can be solved also by the transition periods. And a lot of things can also be solved during the negotiations with Ukraine by offering them also certain support, like we were getting a lot of public support, for example, the whole environmental sector. Ukraine will be devastated environment-wise because of the war. So there will be a lot of investment needed and a lot of also funding, which partially can be private investment, partially can be from the EU budget. So if we go step by step through all those things, we can find solutions that would generate less risk, if I understand you also correctly, less risk to the situation of the current members, and especially those that are similar in terms of comparative advantages to Ukraine. I'm worrying more about democracy, about rule of law. I'm also hoping that the incredible civil society that we have in Ukraine, who are also involved in helping war situations, that they will be a good kind of guardian of the democracy. They will not allow it in the situation. This is where I'm really worrying. And of course, corruption, which we, no matter what Ukraine does, and they have all the institutions they invest in to fight with the perception. So there's a lot still to be done. So there are those things like that, which will be an issue. And but we just... We have no other option, I think. It will be cheaper for us to help Ukraine now, to get them in, than to let Putin
thank you, Danuta. And maybe perhaps your last one, Nicholas McLean.
Thank you very much. I wondered, in view of the very close historical links between Poland and Hungary, whether the return of Donald Tusk will have a favorable impact on the development of politics in Hungary, weakening Orban's positions and helping the opposition there. And one other different point, if I may ask it, is do you see Donald Tusk being able to speed up deliveries of weapons and ammunition to Ukraine?
Mm. Well, you know, on Hungary, I think the situation there is slightly different than in Poland, so there's no time to discuss that. But you could see that already last week there was an unexpected huge demonstrations in Budapest in Hungary. So I think that's certain maybe waking up of the civil society, because he destroyed actually the civil society as well, the media, and he changed the constitution, which in Poland they didn't manage to do it. So the situation is really difficult, but I trust that they are looking at us, and I think Poland doesn't happen too often, which is change to democracy through elections. Normally, it's just you have to fight a revolution or something like that. We did it through elections, so I think this is also a hope for the Hungarians, and I trust they will just move in this direction. Now, on the weapons, you know, it's just a European challenge, because we don't know who will win, of course, in US. But whoever wins, I think Europe has to understand that we might be left alone without US when it comes to the support for military or arm support related to provision of the arms and to Ukraine. So we have to do much more than we are doing now. We know we cannot do it overnight to increase the production, but we most likely will have to start buying also arms and weapons for Ukraine. Unfortunately, probably from US, if I can just say it this way. We already know how to get money for European Union. We can use again Eurobonds. We can go to the markets and get funding because there is no other option. Europe, I think, understands the price of Ukraine losing the war, and we cannot afford it because that brings all the risks just sort of closer to the rest of Europe. So we will be doing it, and I think Tusk understands it very very well, and we just have to probably continue buying. We cannot just change the size of the production just overnight, which I think is the reality that we don't have. So that's why also working together with UK, I think part of the discussion between Tusk and David Cameron was exactly about this cooperation also with you, and not only it's trying to influence Joe Biden, or let's hope it will be Joe Biden, but also to do what we can to help Ukraine to not to move to defensive for longer period, because they have to win this, whatever is the word we with the right word for the end of this war, we don't know, but let's just try to also be more effective on sanctions. There is a lot of leaking sanctions, and we have to isolate really Putin, and we also have to do everything so that the allies are with us, stay with us, to in support for Ukraine, and you are, whether you want it or not, a close ally now for Ukraine.
Thank you very much.
Can I finally ask you, there's been discussion in the British press about the possible revival of the old Weimar Triangle of Poland, Germany and France. Is that a discussion that's continued in Poland, or is it isn't optimistic?
Yeah, we start, you know, it used to be a very important triangle, if I can say it this way. I remember when also that we were trying just probably 20, 15 years ago also to deepen it and to have it also at local and regional level among the people, so to make more of it. But then with the previous government, it was with this German phobia and obsession, and also against France, we did a previous government did a lot of mistake when it comes to giving up on the Caracalla, on the helicopter delivery from France. So it's just a lot of mistakes done. And now the first thing practically that Tusk did with our foreign minister Radek Sikorski, they went for the Weimar Triangle meeting in Paris, and then I think also in Berlin, and they are serious about making the Weimar Triangle again being influential, important, helping and deciding on many things, not only for the three of us, but also in the European context, because I think Europe has to strengthen also its capacity to act. And I was always thinking that in Europe we need the kind of avant-garde. We are too big, too many of us, so that we have, I think, to have leaders or whatever you call it. And you are gone, so we have to do it without you. And we'll try to make the Weimar Triangle also being a kind of a powerful pusher or puller for the European Union, whatever is needed to make us also more relevant globally and more efficient, effective, and a lot of, we didn't discuss all the challenges, no? There's still China somewhere there and other things, but I think, and my dream is also have triangle, transatlantic, trans-channel and continent, so continent U and US. I hope one day we will see for standard setting for business working in one space and a lot of things that we could do together, and I hope one day we will do it. But we are wasting time sometimes, as you know.
Okay, well, thank you. And of course, you also have a new player next door to you in Finland with a former colleague of ours, Alex Stubb, who's now in charge of that country. So it's with his policies, which may not be quite the same as Donald Trump.
Let's hope Sweden will also come.
Yeah.
The next
anyway, Danuta, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Very generous with your time and given us some real food for thought on the answers you've given to the various questions that we've put. And we could go on for another hour, I suspect, but that would be too much for you.
Thank you.
We're very grateful and thank wish you. You well and wish Poland well and wish Donald Tusk well in his efforts to bring Poland back into democracy, if I can call it that.
And so, all the best to you as well, because I think allies should be strong to build strong alliances. So I think absolutely. We have to be strong. Yeah,
absolutely. Can I then just finally say to anyone who's not a member of the CEF at the moment and would like to join, then please visit our website, which is conservativeeuropeanforum.com, and you'll see all the details about it, how to join, how to be involved. So thank you, particularly to Danuta, but to everyone who's joined us this evening.
Thank you. Bye. Good night.